So for the past 1 year, we've been working on this really, really huge Joomla project. So it's the mission is basically, like we said, so it's basically powering the largest education platform for kids in India. And the platform obviously is, while it's being built for kids, I mean, it's a learning platform, so it's an open platform, which we will see in the slides to come. So quick thing about me, so I'm CTO of TechJoomla. You can find me on Twitter, email. So at our company, so there's three actually. So with TechD, we do consultancy and bespoke development. With TechJoomla, we have some real popular extensions like the Shika LMS, JGIB, which is crowdsourcing, ticketing, e-commerce, that's what we have. And with App Car, we actually build mobile apps, and Home API is one of our products with App Carvers, which gives an API backend to Joomla. So yeah, that's a quick thing. So yeah, so here's the thing. So the problem is lack of access to learning opportunities. That's a problem that we're trying to solve. So imagine, I mean, there's a kid who shows, he has a spark, he's a brilliant kid, but because of lack of access to learning opportunities, he starts falling behind, and maybe he can't even be the next Einstein. The other thing, I mean, so Einstein probably, yes, I mean, not all kids are Einstein, but even some kids who lack opportunities eventually might just end up as dropouts. So in India, that's one of the key issues, where people leave school at like fourth grade, fifth grade, and then they keep on falling behind in education. So that's the problem that we're trying to solve. And the goal is to impact 200 million children in India, as well as other similar placed countries in the next 4 years. So that's the lofty goal that this organization is has taken up. So the organization is called EkStep, and the idea is to solve this problem with technology. So Till now, we've been learning out of textbooks. Textbooks are like static material, so static websites, not dynamic. Things don't move, images don't come out. So quality content is the first thing that is being targeted. The quality content, because we can iterate over content that's online, we can improve the content, bring in effectiveness. And then there can also be an analytics loop where which content are kids liking, how are they learning based on which content? So that is the kind of things we have. And because it's online and it's open, anyone can come in and start creating content. So if you have a great idea of how to teach counting, you can come on board, create content, kids can start using it. Or if you're a great illustrator, come in, share an idea of what you can draw, and maybe some mathematician can collaborate with you and start creating content. So it's a collaborative platform where people with their own interests can come on board together to create really high quality content. So like I said, it matches the resources like audio assets, images, with people who are academicians, teachers, who know how to teach, and then that's how the gap gets bridged. So it's a solution. So at the very core, we have a lot of infrastructure. So this infrastructure is really something that's not Joomla. So we're using Neo4j as the graph database here. I'll probably go to the technology stack in the next few slides. So that's the core. On top of that, we have a learning platform, a very slim learning platform, which is really a set of APIs where we can store content, retrieve content, create recommendations, bunch of those tools. There's one more layer outside of it where, based on this set of APIs, we have created something like Google Slides, where you can actually create content, add images, add videos, make it interactive, create plugins, and that again, it uses the learning framework and tools. And again, the very outside, now this is where the Joomla part comes in, the user experience layer, that is entirely based on Joomla. So this is, so what we've done is an entire API mashup. So all of these platform tools that are exposed as APIs have Joomla faces, and that's what about. So quick thing about the EkStep project, so it's a pretty high profile project. This man here co-founded India's biggest IT company, Infosys. both of them together are building India's biggest. So India has a biometric identity platform called as Aadhaar, and these guys together are building it. So 100 crore people, right? So that's lots of data to store for biometric deduplication. So it's a pretty huge system. They are also spearheading online payments in India. So we have digital payments, mobile wallets. So these guys are pretty much evangelizing the entire digitization of the Indian scene. So, and they're the same ones who are actually with EkStep. So here's a quick overview of how it all works. So a user who's an end user, who's maybe let's start there. So the EkStep portal, which is the Joomla face, is actually coordinating with all these people. So there's a creator, the service providers, which can be NGOs who want to teach children or want to create content. They create content which is delivered through a mobile device. So although the content is created on the web, the delivery is through mobile devices because that has the maximum reach in the small villages. So users use the mobile device to learn on the content, and this feedback going back to the entire platform of how kids are performing, which content is doing better. So that's the visual overall. Yeah, so that's so there's one more schematic of the same thing. So like I said, the most inside, we have a lot of APIs. So we have a learning platform which contains the actual content. We have a language platform. So think of it like a thesaurus, but in multiple languages. So we have English thesaurus, Hindi thesaurus. So there's like 24 languages in India. We have pretty much, not all of them, but at least half of them at this point. Then we have a very mature analytics platform, which I'll come to in the next. So it's not just Google Analytics, but it does a lot of more big data analytics for recommendations, for how to improve your content, a lot of it. Then because there's so much content, we need a really good search. So there's an Elasticsearch based search service that we have. And ultimately, there's an ecosystem platform, which is like the infrastructure managing all these infrastructures. On top of that, we have something called as an API gateway. So all of these are independent microservices. We have a single point of entry, which is an API gateway. It's powered by a software called as Kong. And this is what gets exposed to the entire world, where anyone who wants to come into the platform goes through the API gateway and can access any of these APIs. So we have a really bleeding edge technology stack over here. So for all of our telemetry stuff, we are using Apache Kafka, which is if you heard of RabbitMQ or if you heard of messaging, it's kind of a real time streaming messaging data software. So we keep on sending telemetry and it keeps on collecting and then passing it on to, so data pipelines, that's what it is. We have Spark jobs which analyze data, convert them into meaningful visualizations, I mean JSON, which can be visualized. We have Amazon S3, which we're using for data warehousing. So all of the telemetry that comes in through Kafka is stored into S3. The Spark jobs reads those S3 data, converts them into meaningful visualizations. And then we have Cassandra for our data storage. Like I said, we also have Neo4j as our graph database, which stores all of the learning content, the language, and a lot more data of the entire learning experience. And like I said, we have Kong, which is an API manager. So think of Kong like Nginx, but specifically for APIs. So that's what Kong is.
Question, is that done in-house, or do you have external people to... Because that's a wide range of...
Yeah, so it's actually close to 60 people. The Joomla team is like 10, and the rest of the 40 are all these various platforms. So in fact, they've engaged like 8 different organizations. We are one of them. The rest of the 7 do work on various platforms. But Joomla is really... So because everything is internal, it's all APIs, Joomla is what gives them the face. So the output is Joomla. Behind the scenes, it's all APIs. So that's the structure that we have. Yeah, so because, like you said, because it's a pretty big initiative, I mean, a lot of interesting things have come out. So we have close to 80-90 servers. In fact, if I'm not wrong, the last Amazon bill ran close to $10,000. So that's a huge stack. So what we have is we're using Terraform for codifying the infrastructure. So Terraform, think of it like writing code, but if you execute the code, it spawns servers, create networks, all of that. So that's Terraform. We use Ansible for all of our automated deployments. And because there's so many servers, we want some kind of eyes on our infrastructure. So we use Sensu for gathering data from the servers. So in fact, Terraform also takes care of installing Sensu and all these clients on our servers. So data is continuously gathered in terms of what services are running, what's going down, what's going in, what's eating more CPU, how many requests are we serving per second. All of the data is inside Sensu. And then we use Uchiva, which works well with Sensu to catch alerts, disk space alerts, CPU alerts, RAM alerts. And I think like most of you guys do, for CI, CD, we use Jenkins. We're also doing a lot of automated tests, not just codeception tests, which test functionality in a browser, but we're doing a lot of PHP unit tests. So that's one key area that we're trying to get more into. And that's where we've seen Joomla's unit testing infrastructure a little limiting, where there's not too many examples of doing mocks of database activities. So yeah, so enough of the tech stuff, so let's probably quickly look at features. So this is something cool. So so while we learn, we don't realize there's so much information that we're learning. So and when teaching kids, it's important to actually teach them the right things at the right age and also understand what they're learning. So for that, what we have is a huge pedagogy. So the pedagogy is divided into three domains right now, which is literacy, meaning language, numeracy is equivalent to math, and science. And each of these has anywhere between 50 to 1,000 small concepts to teach. So as an example, in numeracy, we have a concept called as counting. And counting will have further subdivisions, and it can go as grained as single digit counting, single finger counting, two hand counting. So these are all the things that kids need to learn as children, and those are all the concepts that have been there in the entire concept map. And each learning content is mapped to the concept. So as kids learn, we start seeing what concept they're learning, what are they good at, what are they bad at, what should they be learning next. So all those kind of things are possible through this concept map. Then, so here's the challenge. So although the content gets created online, the kids are in villages where internet obviously is not so much of a reality. So all of the content needs to be played offline. So the way it works is content gets created online, people add images, they add audio, they add effects. So all of the content that gets created needs to be packaged as a single archive that can be played offline. So for that, we created something called as the ECML, it's called EkStep, EkStep Content Markup Language. So it's kind of JSON or XML, supports both. And it's a format which can contain the actual content, the text inside it, the images in it. And the assets themselves are also bundled. So the ECML has the references, and the archive has the actual assets. So if I import a single archive on my device, the entire thing can play without internet connection. So that's so it's basically an offline first approach that's been taken, and that's the reason we needed to really create our own markup format. Yeah. So these are the key user roles that we have. Obviously, we have a lot more, but on a high level, we have a content creator. So obviously, with an open platform like this, you can expect to get any kind of submissions. So it's important to also have a review process. So we have content creators who can come on board, create content. The review process takes care of ensuring that there's a certain amount of quality that is met when content gets created. So there's a review process, and then partner users. So partner users are important for this ecosystem because they are the ones who are working directly with children. So they run programs, they run kid learning things, and they are also instrumental in actually getting help to create the content. So that's another use case. Yeah, so now this is the heart and soul of the platform, which is the content library. So I'll probably jump in and out of demos in a few minutes, but yeah, so it's like I said, it's collaboratively built. Anyone can go to the site, start creating. You can add your friends as collaborators. So if you're great at creating stories, but not so good at maybe how to teach, you can get your teacher friend on board and you can together create a nice content. So it's collaborative. And on the consumption side, anyone can browse through the entire library, download content, play it on the app. So EkStep also has an app that goes with it. Yeah, so now this is the tool that I talked about to actually create content. So it's very similar to Google Slides. So it's a custom JavaScript based implementation that we have. It's based on Fabric.js. It's very powerful canvas library, and like I said, any author might invite community members to contribute. So that's the content creation part. So once content creation happens, this is the review process. So the review process, so this quick screenshot of how it works. So any reviewer can look at the content, he can flag it for some violations. With this, there's like a loop that happens between the reviewer and the creator. If the reviewer finds there's some problems, sends it back to the creator. The creator addresses these concerns, sends it back, so it kind of goes in a ping. So a lot like Joomla's publishing cycle, it ping-pongs between the publisher and the reviewer till the reviewer agrees and it makes it live, so it's visible for everyone. So that's the review cycle. The next part is pretty interesting. So so we saw that numeracy and literacy are two key areas, and as part of literacy, having a wordnet, having a really powerful wordnet is key. So and when you create a wordnet, I mean a thesaurus, basically it's important to have in a thesaurus examples, important to have examples that are relevant to the age group you're teaching. So in this thesaurus, we obviously have tons of words. But what we have also have is age appropriate words, meaning each word is marked if it's good to teach to a first grade kid or a second grade kid or a fourth grade kid. And based on that, there's examples. So think of it like thesaurus.com or dictionary.com, but with much more relevant information that's needed for school kids. And the best part is that there's the English version of it. And then we have it around in around 12 Indian languages, and we have Neo4j is a graph database. We can actually connect these words to each other based on the language metadata. So, like we have here, share, the topmost green circle means line. So I can actually connect these words together. So if someone is creating a language content in English, it's not too hard to translate it into any other language because we have a lot of things which are pretty much ready. And obviously, in a lot of places, we are also trying to piggyback and use existing infrastructure like Google provides translations. We're using that. Google also provides, by the way, an image recognition API. So you can actually call the API to rule out profanity images, pornographic images, and ensure that the images are clean. And you can also extract metadata from images, like if it's the sun setting, Google gives you the sun as a keyword, ocean as the keyword. And then we can actually use that to do some more automated reviews of our content. So that's what's happening, but that's in the back end, I think, in Joomla. So again, when building maths questions, another, or even English questions, you would often need some kind of quizzes, question answers. So what we also have is a collaborative question bank where people can create questions, again tag them with the concept map, tag them with the grades, and these questions are stored in the common question bank. So anyone who wants to create questions can obviously make their own, but you can also use existing questions. So that's the question bank. Yeah, now this is where things get really interesting. So initially the thought was to use Google Analytics, but then we realized that probably would be too limiting, and at the same time our data stays with Google servers. So we went ahead and created our own telemetry specification. So it's based on JSON. So we have like a defined structure of JSON in which we send all telemetry data. And then we are doing cool things like, so in fact, telemetry happens at several layers. So simplest form of telemetry is that when a kid is doing a content on his phone, we we track all tabs. We track which questions he's doing wrong, which questions he's doing right. So based on this, we can give recommendations through content creator to enrich his content. So for example, there's a question which has four examples, and none of the kids can get that question right. That means that maybe the options are not too nice or the question is too hard. So that feedback is given back to the content creator saying, this question, nobody could get it right. Why don't you improve it? So that's one part of the telemetry. But what we also do is the Joomla itself, we track pretty much each and every click that you do on the screen. So for example, an interesting thing is, so let's say you have a form with 50 fields, and we track which fields people click. So if you realize that there's 50 fields and people only tend to fill fields which are at the bottom of the form, we know that only those fields people are using. So what we do is, based on the telemetry usage, we actually move them on the top. So it's easier for people to fill the form. So that's the kind of analytics that we're doing on Joomla. So we're tracking, we're obviously doing all standard stuff that Pivik or Google does, but with this click tracking, we're able to do a lot more cooler things like, so if you've seen Kissmetrics or those kind of tools, so very similar to that. And in the future, obviously, the plan is to, yeah. So this actually depends. So this needs the entire backend stack to work. But what we're releasing is the plugin that we've created that lets you send telemetry to any provider. So we're actually thinking of how we can convert this into a way where anyone can use. Because right now, because the format is pretty specific to our use case, so we need to kind of generalize it, make it more general, then we can get it out. But yeah, that's the idea.
Was it hard to balance feedback and analytics related to data usage from the users?
No, oh, sorry, I.
And you know, so obviously it's great to get as much information as possible, but then I guess all analytics that comes back is using their data plan and their robot post. So was it hard to balance the amount of information you collect versus the amount of data?
Yes, exactly. So the way it works on mobile devices is that any activity does not go straight to the internet. There's a buffer that stores it, and obviously when there's connectivity does it prompt you, do you want to sync, and you say sync, and then so on the web obviously that's not a problem because it's always online. Mm-hmm. But on mobile devices, yes, that's exactly what we do. So yeah, and obviously the plan in the future is to do a lot of more cool things like A/B testing. One more important area that, in fact, if any of you were in today morning's JED session by Alexander, we touched upon the search aspect. So that's another thing that we're trying to do over here where, so how do you think Google improves its searches over time? So let's say you type for Joomla. And first page comes, you don't like anything, you go to page 2, go to page 3, you go to page 5, and then on page 5, you click one of the links. And then now Google knows that when you type Joomla, you clicked on page 5 result and not a page 1 result. And if a lot more people keep on doing that, Google knows that, okay, the result on page 5 is much more relevant than on page 1. So it tries to move it up the queue. So that's exactly what we're trying to do over here, where we have a search telemetry. We do page tracking, which result is on which page and what users click on. So we don't do search improvements yet, but yes, we are tracking that data right now on which serial number people click on. So in the future, we can probably use that to improve, bump up the result. So the philosophy that EkStep is following is that data is the new dollar. So they're pretty heavy on big data analytics and getting all sorts of cool data. Yeah, and then like I said, so because there's so many community features, we have so we're using Easy Social over here to give the community features. We're using groups, we're using discussions to foster creation of specific groups. So if there's a group of teachers who are specialized into teaching Vedic mathematics, for example, so they can create a group, start discussing between themselves, start creating content that's specific to their expertise area. So that's the social aspect of it. And then because it's an open platform, we have open APIs, and then we need to have a developer ecosystem where we document our APIs, we give code examples. So we have a separate developer section where people can go, they can generate their own Kong credentials, which gives access to their APIs. We have a lot of documentation. So we're using Swagger for that. Swagger is like a way to describe your APIs. We have code examples. We have the phone SDK documentation. So that's a bunch of things. And this is all built on top of plain Joomla articles. So this obviously, the creating credentials is a specialized extension, but everything else is Joomla. Yeah, so everything that we saw right now in the features is Joomla. So that's a custom extension that's built, which talks to these backend APIs, gives you various features, searching of content, creating content, the word intent that we saw. All of that is specialized Joomla extension. So yeah, like I said, so the idea here is to use Joomla more as a extension development platform, like a framework, than your regular CMS. So that's what we've been doing for so long. So not using Joomla as a CMS, but use it as a solid application development platform, which is good. I mean, it's doing pretty good at that. So that's what we've been doing. So next we'll probably work through some key design patterns in terms of technology that we kind of realized we were doing. So right now, Joomla architecture is geared towards building database driven applications. So everything that you do is really database models. But like I said, we have a very refined content platform, language platform, and all the stuff that we're doing in Joomla needs to talk to an API and not a database. So the idea here was to create a service layer. So if you see over here, the regular Joomla way is to go from a view to a model and to a table class. But with the service-based approach, the table class gets replaced by a service, which actually talks to. So it's nothing but implementation of JHTTP because we have HTTP APIs. But this structure allows us to kind of tomorrow swap out the service with something else if we need to. So that's the implementation. So it's the service layer that we call it. That's what this is, and the same thing about the service layer is what we are also implementing in JavaScript. So the front end. One issue that we've been seeing a lot of times is developers tend to mix DOM manipulation, like jQuery stuff, with logic stuff, which is like communicating with APIs. So even in the JavaScript layer, we've separated the two, where we have a JavaScript UI layer, which does your showing and hiding form fields, displaying AJAX data into dropdowns. And then the layer that actually communicates with the API to get the AJAX call is completely different. So there's like two different files, and then those both can be worked on separately. So there's no mixing of, so it's like the model views of JavaScript. That's what this is, or maybe controller views, whatever you call it. So, so while doing this, obviously, like I said, we have so at this point, the project, the platform is just coming out. So we've had like 4 customers come on board. All are governments, by the way. So in India, there's like 27 states. So 4 state governments are coming on board, and we realized very quickly that a regular hosting setup would not be sufficient. So we'll have to scale. We'll have to go into high availability load balancing. So recently, we migrated to a platform where we have a load balancing setup. So what we have is we have Nginx as the front server. Behind Nginx, we use Amazon's ELB, and behind ELB, we have like at least three nodes that run the Joomla application, and all of them connect to the same RDS. So that's the stack that we have, a load balance stack. There were some challenges that we have when we use this stack. So like I said, we have Nginx, ELB, EC2 servers, RDS. One interesting thing that we realized that when we did this, we could not use Joomla admin's force SSL because it used to actually create a redirect loop at the ELB. So all of that happens at Nginx. So a lot of the configuration things, a lot of the admin things that we kind of think are too easy to do in the Joomla admin needed a radical shift to some other approach. So for example, we can no longer use the Joomla admin to save any configuration because the same code is on 3 different servers, and at any point you only connect to one server. So if you save the Joomla, if you save the metadata into one server, you are not essentially updating all 3 servers, you are only updating one server. So all of that happens through our Ansible deployment code. So all of that happens through Jenkins. We can't use, in a way it's limiting, but obviously that's a small price to pay for the flexibility, the availability that we are gaining out of that. The other thing that we realized is sessions. So obviously, by default, Joomla, I think, stores sessions on disk. That again causes a problem because with an ELB setup, you cannot be sure which server the user hits on every request. So at this point, we're storing sessions in the database. But pretty soon we might need to migrate to something like 3DIS or memcached. The other interesting thing that we realized in terms of load balancing is file storage. So I would say 90% of the extensions assume that all the uploaded files get stored into a certain folder. But with the load balance setup, you have 3 different instances or maybe more than one instances that has the files, and you cannot upload files to one single server. They have to be there always. So one way to tackle this is obviously use S3, which was like the most obvious thing. But the problem is different extensions implement S3 differently. And one of the security concerns that we had over here is to not hard code any S3 credentials. So AWS supports something called as policy based access, where the credentials are hard coded into the OS. And none of the existing S3 implementations support that. So we could have obviously changed the extension, but it was too much work. So ultimately, we settled with a plain old NFS implementation where the we had to change all the extensions to store uploaded files in images, and the images folder was a linked NFS installation, which works. That's the non-consistent story. And then I think the last one is a problem that we face a lot of times, where all extensions have their own CSS and it doesn't look as though it's the same site. So there's some work involved to ensure that all the extensions look as though they are the same site and not different sections on the site. So that's something that we had to tackle. What does Joomla have to gain? So we're looking at actually a bunch of pull requests, few of them already merged. So one thing that is pretty nice is we're trying to do inline editing for JForm. So right now when you edit any form, it actually loads the entire form. But we had a need to do inline editing. It's implemented already in the project. We are like, we're kind of making it generic so that it can be made as a pull request to JForm. So that's one area. But the second thing was pretty important for telemetry. So like I said, we are tracking each and every click. But when we track a click, without any context, it's useless to know that something was clicked. So what you're doing is, for each element, for each button, for each input field, for each link, we are adding data hyphen telemetry with the relevance that we want over there. But the thing was, JForm didn't let us allow adding data hyphen stuff into fields. So there's a pull request which I think just got accepted before we came here. So now JForm can support adding data hyphen fields, so that's an enhancement. And this is the one class that we're trying to make it generic. The enhanced analytics where we can do all sorts of cool stuff in analytics. So we're in the process of seeing how we can generalize it. But yeah, pretty soon we should be able to figure out what's the best way to do it. And so like I said, the last one, so because we're using Jenkins and Git for our deployment, all our extension updates get passed through as files and get there's no installation happening, the files get copied. And because there's an installation, typically when you upgrade an extension, when you upgrade the SQL scripts run, but when you copy files, the scripts don't run. Well, if you do that with, now when you do that with Joomla, Joomla has a fixed database option, where if you manually upgrade, you click that and the database gets updated. But unfortunately, that's not supported for third-party extensions yet. So what we've done is we've supported third parties for the fix option, and that's on its way again as a pull request. So there's obviously more to come as we start seeing more challenges and start addressing them. So I'll probably quickly take you through a demo of a few of them. Feel free to stop me if you want to see something specific. Oops, this is too big. This is the homepage. We have a search for content. Down below we have this content. So yeah, looks like it needs some responsive work. But yeah, usually it won't look, on a bigger screen you'd see those as pins. So that's the content repository that we have. This is the word, the thesaurus that I was talking about. So we have these many languages having words right now. Like you see, English has close to 1 lakh words, Hindi has around that many. And then, obviously this won't have as many words because these are being curated specifically for words that kids can understand. So that's the word net. I'll quickly show the edit in place that we have. Let me change to English to understand. So this is what we have. So each of the fields can be edited in place. So we support text fields, we support drop downs, we even support repeatable fields. So subform supported. So this is the pull request that we are really working on. We really hope to get this in because this would be a really great feature for Joomla, where you can not just open the entire form, but edit each field individually in place on the view itself. So that's another area. So the domains is what, so I was talking about the concept map. So it's like a, we have numeracy, literacy, science. So within numeracy, we have, we're looking at a dev side. Yeah. Numeracy, which has these many concepts, these are the sub-concepts, sub-sub-concepts. Similarly, we have literacy, we have science. So that's the entire pedagogical map that we have, where it has all these links, link concepts. And if you go to any of the content pieces, so you go to lessons. So if you visit any of these lessons, each lesson is tagged with this concept. So if you see over here, it's tagged with numeracy, and you'll also see concepts somewhere which is tagged with. So which it basically gives us a way where we know what kids are learning, what concept they're learning. And based on those concepts, if they answer questions right in the test, or maybe if they answer wrong, we can actually suggest more lessons having the same concept to them. So that way they keep on learning. And finally, yeah, this is the developer area. So like I said, we have a pretty comprehensive APIs. It's an open platform, so API documentation, code examples. We have all of that. This is a place where we can generate own credentials. So this works with the Kong to get your own credentials. So a lot like develop Facebook or Twitter developer area, where you create credentials, use them, start making your app. All right, so I think that was largely it.